Good morning, Arden Hills. Are we ready to praise our Lord music? Before we get started, I like oldies. And this song is an oldie. As you look in our hymnals, you'll see 1700s. This song was sung in 1740. And Lord, I Want to Be a Christian is American spiritual. It was likely composed in the 1750s, Virginia, by African-American slaves exposed to the teaching of evangelist Samuel Davis. The music and lyrics were first printed in 1907. So it wound up in our hymnals in 1907, but it was sung in the 1740s, 1750s. Lord, I Want to Be a Christian. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be a Christian in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart, in my heart, in my heart. Lord, I want to be more loving in my heart. Lord, I want to be more holy in my heart, in my heart.
There's pink cards in front of you on the pews there. If you have a prayer request, and please write it down and bring it up. Raise your hands, and the deacon will come by and pick it up, and we'll lay these prayers down on God's throne. Our next song is "Blessed Assurance, Jesus Is Mine." 462 in your hymnals.
Thank you.
Praise Him, praise Him. Can I get you to all stand as we stand? Stand, Carl. Rejoice and praise your name because you are so good to us. You have brought us here this morning to worship. You brought us here to sing. You brought us here to listen to the message, but also you brought us here that we may share with one another the blessings of God this week. Now we ask that you would bless us together. May we leave this place knowing that God has been with us and we have been with Him. In the name of Jesus, we ask this. Let the church say, amen. Please be seated.
Children, children, come and listen. Come and hear of Jesus' love. Children,
testing.
Children,
time for children's story. Come on up here.
How Jesus loves. Children, children, come and touch Him. Come and touch our Bible friend. Children,
Well, I'm so glad to see you this morning. This story is about a family that lived on a farm. Now, Dad was gone. He had to go on a trip far away. And poor Mama, she was on crutches. She couldn't walk very well, so she had to go very slow, and it hurt. And then Sister was just about ready to go to college, so she grabbed the ashes from the fireplace, and she went outside and threw them in the ash pile near the barn. And next thing you know, there were two boys left in the family that I haven't told you about yet. David was 9 years old, and Gordon was 6. And David looked out the window, and he saw smoke going up in the air, and he yelled, "Fire, fire!" And Mom said, "What? What's on fire?" And David said, "Look, Mom." And Mom said, "Oh no, what can she do? What can she do? She is on crutches. Mama can't run and put the fire out." She said, "David, quick, get some pails of water. Get some pails, go down to the little stream and get some water." The stream was about 50 yards away. Oh my, that was about half the size of a football field. And he ran outside. He grabbed two pails, and David ran to the water. And Gordon, he was 6 years old, he says, "I can help too." And he got one bucket. And so the three buckets, two boys went back and forth. I have a picture of them. They're trying to put the water out with their buckets. The fire out with their buckets of water. Oh my goodness, they are going fast as they little legs could go. And they went back and forth to the stream. And their legs were getting so tired, but they had to keep going. And Mama yelled, "Save the gas tank! Don't let the fire get near the gas!" And so the boys ran and poured water all over the fire that was going to the gas tank, because Daddy had a gas tank with gas in it for his tractor. And Mama didn't want that to explode, and then the fire would spread fast. Well, as they were running, they were saying a prayer. "Dear Jesus, please help us. Dear Jesus, please help us, because we're just two little boys, and it's a big fire." And they prayed every time they went back and forth, and pretty soon they thought their legs were getting so tired that they wouldn't be able to go anymore. And the wind did something special. The wind changed directions. How about that? Instead of blowing in one direction, the wind turned around and blew a different way. And it blew that fire all the way over to the water that was running in the stream. And when the fire got to the water, it couldn't burn anymore, because it can't burn water. And the fire went out all by itself. Oh my goodness, was that an answer to prayer for the little boys? Yes, they were so glad that they were able to save the farm and the barn, and they didn't burn the house. Jesus answered their prayers. So when you're in a terrible situation like that, you can pray to Jesus. But also, I want you to know, boys and girls, don't fight the fires by yourself, okay? Please, if your house is on fire, run out. Don't be a brave firefighter. But this was an outdoor thing, and these little boys were doing what Mama told them to do. So you be careful with fire, and when you're in a terrible situation, ask Jesus for help, and he'll do miracles for you. Okay? Thank you very much. You may go back to your seats.
Excuse you? What? Oh, down. Thank you. Thank you. I'm 5'1", but the Word of God makes me feel 6 feet. It's an honor to read the Word of God, but it's much better to go to Bible study on Wednesday nights and now Friday. Okay, we have responsive reading, so I guess I get to read the first part, and then you all get to read the second part, if you will. Help me. Okay, to this end, Christ died and lived again, that he might be Lord both of the dead and of the living. For as by a man came death, by a man has come also the resurrection of the dead. For as in Adam all die, so also in Christ shall all be made alive. I think that's all of you. Sorry. Good job, Danny. For the Lord himself will descend from heaven with a cry of command, with the archangel's call, and with the sound of the trump of the God, and the dead in Christ will rise first. Lo, I tell you a mystery. We shall not all sleep, but we shall all be changed in a moment, in the twinkling of an eye, at the last trumpet. For the trumpet will sound, and the dead will be raised imperishable, and we shall be changed. Awesome. Yeah.
The deacons come forward, please. Well, the offering is for church budget, and let me tell you a little bit what's going on with our money, so you know it's going to good use. Well, you know, we got lights, electricity, gas, supplies, maintenance, gardener, housekeeping. That's all under budget, and we're in the process of painting the church, and we have this, what they call the deck here. We're still trying to get some bids on it to fix that. And we got stairs on both sides that needs, part of it needs to be replaced. It all takes money. And with our good offering that we get, we're gonna be a beacon on the hill when we're done with our maintenance work. So we appreciate everything that you can give. Shall we bow our heads? Our Heavenly Father, we thank you for this beautiful Sabbath day. We thank you for this well-needed rain. We thank you for the people that can give and the people that can't give. So we ask you for this holy day that we love you so much that we pour out all our offerings for you, because it's not our money, it's your money. We ask in your Son, Jesus' precious name, amen. Thank you.
Well, we have a number of prayer requests. James starts out with a thank you, God, for the snow and rain. Certainly it's something we've been needing. He also asks that we pray for Nathaniel, Andrew, Renee, Lucas, Daniel, and the church. Please heal and strengthen each one. Ed Sumsky says, please pray for my mom, who is in a rehabilitation site recovering from congestive heart failure. And another heart problem, Telma Hill asks that we pray that her daughter-in-law's heart be restored. This is Angela. She will be having surgery on Tuesday, and she needs a miracle. I think we all need a heart restoration. Amber and Bonnie both ask that we pray for April and her family, as April's sister Frances died. And Danny offers a prayer that I think all of us can agree with, even regardless of who we voted for. He says, pray for our new president and his cabinet, for success in their administration of our great Constitution, so long as it is within God's will. Amen. All of you who are able, if you would kneel with me as we pray. Father in heaven, you've given us so much. You've given us the rain, you've given us your love, and especially you have given us your Son who died for our sins. And we thank you for all that. And we would ask that you fill our hearts with your holiness, with your love, and with your Son, that we may grow closer to you, to him, and to all those around us, and serve you here. We also would ask for your blessing on all of those who were in need of, are in need of prayer, which of course is all of us, but particularly for those that we have spoken of this morning, those who were ill and injured in both body and spirit. And we would ask that you lead us, send your Spirit to us as we are here together today, and to our pastor as he brings a message to us. And Lord, in an echo of what Martin Luther King said about being free at last, as our pastor is speaking of being at home at last, we would ask, Lord, that we will be able to say in that new earth and in the new Jerusalem, we are home at last. In Jesus' name, amen.
Hey. Thank our special music this morning. It's always wonderful to hear good songs that bring back to memory good things that happens to the Christian. And I appreciate that very much. Well, loved ones, we are moving rapidly, it seems, into 2017. And we are almost coming to the end of this month, looking at February. I could not believe it as I looked at the calendar. I said, that doesn't seem possible. I thought we just had Christmas. But the time goes by very fast when you're enjoying life. And I'll tell you, Arden Hills helps me to enjoy life. And I appreciate being here with you today again. I do have someone I do want to introduce to you today, though, and that is my sister, Carolyn. Carolyn is my sister. She's a sister who I've had for all my life. And I'm older, but she's wiser. And I'm glad that she could be with us this morning. Yes, thank you, Carol. Yes, I was the oldest, and then she was the next oldest, and then we have two others that came after that. I didn't get to know the other two well, because the two of us are the closest in age, and then there's about 10 years difference between me and almost in the other ones. So it makes a difference. But I wanted you to know my sister is here today. Yes. On last Sabbath, we had the joy of listening to an individual bring some thoughts dealing with the seven churches. And I thought as I began looking at what I wanted to do today that I would do a takeoff on that today. And one reason why I am is because basically moving from that, which is dealing with the seven churches, and moving on to the second coming. And then next Sabbath, I'll be dealing with heaven. Dealing with heaven. What's going to take place when we get to the New Jerusalem? And then on the next Sabbath, well, not the next Sabbath, the following Sabbath, after our guest speaker preaches, the following Sabbath, I'll be finishing up the three-part series that deals with what takes place when we come back to this earth from heaven. And I thought you would find that very interesting. I found it in my studies very interesting because basically there's a lot that we don't think about. And there's some things that we don't even think about when it comes to just what is going to take place when Jesus comes back the second time. Anyway, I wanted to let you know that God is waiting for us to get people ready, because ready or not, He's coming. Amen? Amen? Father God, bless us as we speak this morning. May the Spirit of God be with us. In Jesus' name, amen. A churchgoer wrote a letter to the editor of the newspaper complaining that it made no sense to go to church every week. He said, I've gone for 30 years now, and in that time I've heard something like 3,000 sermons. But for the life of me, I can't remember a single one of them. So I think I'm wasting my time, and the pastors are wasting theirs by giving sermons at all. That started a real controversy in the letters to the editor column, much to the delight of the editor. It went on for weeks until someone wrote this clincher. I've been married for 30 years now. In that time, my wife has cooked some 32,000 meals. Wow, 32,000. But for the life of me, I cannot recall the entire menu for a single one of those meals. But I know this, they all nourished me. They gave me the strength I needed to do my work. And if my wife had not given me these meals, I would be physically dead today. Likewise, if I had not gone to church for the nourishment, I would be spiritually dead today. I thought that was good. That spiritually, we must spend time with the Lord day after day. It's not something we do just on Sabbath. It's not something we do when we think about it. It's something that we must have a habit of doing day by day. Because you see, heaven is not given to us, our place where we're going to be, simply because we're Seventh-day Adventists. I'm going to say that again. Heaven is not a place that we're going to be simply because we're Seventh-day Adventists. Because you see, Seventh-day Adventists are as a church that believes in all of the Ten Commandments, believes in everything that God has given us. But also, we must remember this, that salvation doesn't come from being a Seventh-day Adventist. Salvation comes to us because of our relationship with Jesus Christ. That's why a lot of Catholics will be saved in the kingdom, because that's all they knew. They had a relationship with Jesus Christ. A lot of Methodists will be saved because that's all they knew was that, and that they did not know. It's a relationship with Jesus Christ that brings salvation to us. Now, lest you get the wrong idea, I'm not saying that the Seventh-day Adventist Church is not important. The Seventh-day Adventist Church is very important because it's giving God's last message to this world. And that message is very important. God has given this church the gift of prophecy. The church has a gift of prophecy through Ellen G. White. God has given this church also a gift in understanding God's word and understanding what the seventh-day Sabbath means and what it means to look forward to Jesus coming a second time, and that we don't automatically go to heaven when we die. What a terrible thing it would be to go to heaven when you die, and now you got to come back when the second coming comes. You see what I'm saying here basically is this, that when we begin to look at Our message today, loved ones, is a message that God has given this church to give to a dying world, and the Seventh-day Adventist Church is very, very important in that. What do you say? When I read this, it says, "Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, since as members of one body you will be called to peace, and be thankful. Let the message of Christ dwell among you richly as you teach and admonish one another with wisdom through psalms and also through hymns and songs from the Spirit, singing to God with gratitude in your hearts. And whatever you do, whether in word or deed, do it all in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ, giving thanks to God." Well, the question sometimes we get to ask, what was it that God gave us, built? And I have dealt with that subject already once. Was it a hospital system? We have that. We have a wonderful hospital system in the church. Was the education system? Oh, yes, we have that too, because we have a wonderful educational system in this church, all through the world. Was it a social club or a religious clique or maybe a seminar, learn how to do a few things that's so important to the church? No, none of that. What is important to God is His church. Do you believe that? His church is important to Him. When I thought about, when God finally had to say to Adam, "Look, you no longer can stay in the Garden of Eden." Oh, that was a terrible time for him. And I began to look at what took place after that, and I began to look at what happened to Enoch during that time. Because you see, Enoch and Adam were there together. Sometimes we forget that. Enoch was living when Adam was still alive. They had an opportunity to talk together. And Enoch needed Christ as much as we do today. You see, Enoch, he walked with God and he talked with God, yes. But he also had a chance to talk with Adam and talk with Eve. He had a chance to deal with the issues of life and understand what took place in the Garden of Eden. And he recognized the grace that God had given to us through Adam by saying, "I'm going to send one day a Savior who is Christ the Lord, and He will be our Redeemer." Enoch devoted much time to prayer and communion with God, and thus this helped him to escape the corruption that was in the world during that time. Devotion not only guided his footsteps, we're told, it was his devotion to God that fitted him for translation. You see, the Sunday law will be God's sign to His people to sell your homes. I'm going to say that again, because a lot of people say, "Well, when do I need to sell my home? Because I know when I read the Spirit of Prophecy that I need to do that." The Sunday law, she says, will be the sign to sell your home and move out into the country and spend time in the city spreading the gospel of Jesus Christ, the Sabbath, and other messages to the people, but not living in those towns, in those cities. God's words for the last days of Earth's history is that the latter rain is coming, and it seals and it empowers the saints, the people of God, in the very last days. The Sunday law will keep the Sabbath keepers from buying or selling. But the people of God will need to let God take care of their food during this period of time, just before Jesus comes. The last events will then begin to take place very rapidly. Assurance comes when we stop and look at ourselves, and often we find that our own efforts are not what they should be, and that we need to focus on Christ and Calvary as we're getting closer to the end of time. When we focus on people around us, we lack assurance that we need. We look within and we lack assurance also, but when we look at Jesus, He gives us the assurance that we need. We need not
be alone because the Holy Spirit is with us as we seek Him daily. We need time for devotions, loved ones, and we need to have those devotions daily. We need time where we can spend in His Word, and we need to spend His Word daily. We need time when we can sing the songs of Zion just to ourselves and allow those songs to mean something to us. And why? Because we are living in an age of materialism, a time of being spent moving from place to place on the internet. We're more educated, but we're finding less time to seek His will through the study of the Word of God. As we look at the times in which we are living in, we must meet the challenge that is set before this church. The church must meet the challenge with fervent, with deeply studied, incisively applicable, and also presentations of God's Word to our friends and neighbors. When's the last time you went next door and asked your neighbor about coming to church with you? When's the last time you just simply talked about the Bible with your neighbor? I'm not suggesting that that's what you should do. I'm not suggesting that, because I'm saying you shouldn't do that when you first get to that house for the first time. You got to find a way to be a friend to your neighbor before you start to be talking about the Sabbath. They don't want to hear about the Sabbath if you haven't had a relationship with them. Our problem sometimes is that we are so busy that we forget that God is expecting us in the Seventh-day Adventist Church to reach people with this gospel, and we reach it them by spending time with them, talking to them over the fence, going next door and saying, can we sit down and talk about how things are going in our neighborhood even. Don't start out with the Bible. Don't start out. Start out being a friend. Being a friend. A person who enjoys just talking together about different things in the neighborhood. But as we look at ourselves in this day and age, we find ourselves not doing that as often. Because you see, the church now must meet the challenge. The challenge of reaching everyone before Jesus comes. For we have the sure word of prophecy that God has given this church, a message that people will want to know about, a message that God has given this church, and God has given us an understanding of the book of Revelation. Not too many churches talk about the book of Revelation because they don't understand it. But God has given us an understanding, the Seventh-day Adventist Church. So we should spend time studying it. We need to find out what God is looking at as we talk about the seven seals, we talk about the seven trumpets, we talk about the seven churches. That helps us understand our connection to His soon return. It is a study that of the Word that we become excited about Jesus and what He is doing and what He has done and what He will be doing as He prepares to come back to us. Where are we as we look at His second coming? The seven churches do give us a little insight as we move homeward. It's like looking through a window of God's tomorrow through His telescope. In Revelation 1, He's in the midst of the candlesticks. In Revelation 3, He's the Christ, the Lamb. And then you find Him knocking at the door. You find then in Revelation 6, He's Christ coming. In Revelation 7, the Lamb in the midst of the throne. Revelation 10, the little book that must be eaten by the church, sweet to the tongue, but bitter in the stomach. He's a little boy, and the devil waits on him. Revelation 14, the Lamb and the 144,000. Revelation 19, Christ triumphs. Revelation 22, Christ is still coming. We're waiting, but He's still coming. For he that shall come will come and will not tarry, loved ones. You see, Ephesus is the city that lost its love. We're talking about those churches now. It's one that lost its love. A city that died because too much mud accumulated in the harbor. And that's actually what happened. Then Smyrna, about AD 313, a period of pain of the church, a testing and trial within the church, but with no pain, there is no gain. The Lord will allow us to have pain, loved ones, and necessary to save us. For he that will come shall come and will not tarry. Pergamos, The church has let Satan have control now. Idol worship has taken place in the church. Fornication has taken place in the church. False doctrine is in the church. And now we find there are just a few people who are faithful to God within the church during this period of time. Thyatira is also afflicted with the same sins as Smyrna, and it seems to be getting worse, but God states that he has those who are faithful even in Pergamos. And he asks them to hold fast till he comes. Sardis, where you get almost back, but this church is where the Reformation starts to take place, in Sardis. Then comes Philadelphia. The 1844 experience takes place during this time. People sold their belongings, sold their homes, forgave one another, and prepared for Jesus to come that day in 1844 in October. They were thinking Jesus was coming. And when midnight came, they were disappointed. Jesus did not come. They were still there. They were the laughing stock. You sold everything you had. You gave away everything you had. And Jesus didn't come. You were just a bunch of crazy people. The church doesn't know what to think during that period. For they had sold everything they had. But now comes the last church, Laodicea. That's where we are. Laodicea, a church that God said he would spew out of his mouth. A church that was neither hot nor cold. I don't know about you, but I like drinking things that are not either hot or cold. I don't like things that are just lukewarm. I want to spew it out of my mouth. Either it's going to be cold like a good cold water I can drink, or it's going to be hot like hot tea. Could have some of that today. It's been a little cool. But Laodicea is a church that Jesus is trying to wake up, because he's about to come back for those who are homeward bound. He's trying to let them know, I'm about ready to come back, but you are not ready for me to come back. Why are we not ready for Jesus to come back? Because if we were ready, we'd be on the firing field, working hard to bring people into the church. Pastor. You see, it's all right to come to church and enjoy the sermon, enjoy the music, enjoy the time that we're spending together. But it doesn't do much good if no one is out there studying with the people in their area and helping them understand that Jesus is coming soon. What happened to the Seventh-day Adventist church that was studying the Word? What happened to the Seventh-day Adventist church that was busy bringing souls into the church? What has happened to the church that was so busy baptizing that they didn't know where to put the people? Loved ones, what I'm saying here is this, that when you begin to see Laodicea, and it's talking about us, you realize that by the time we get to the end of chapter 3, the church is in a bad state, and the question is, who is going to be saved? I will tell you, a number that no one can number is going to be saved. It is his love that makes him a bridge over troubled water. Jesus is that bridge over troubled water. But we have to bring that bridge to the people so the people will know how to walk over the bridge. Now you know very well all that took place in the seven churches. The four and 20 elders. You know about that. You don't need to talk about that. But I can tell you that when we come to the 144,000, I thought about this when I first looked at it. I said, 144,000. Lord, that's all? 144,000? It kind of scared me. I mean, I want to be among the 144,000 then who are going to be saved. And as I looked at that in Revelation 7, verses 3 and 4, 144,000 are sealed. But the question is, am I going to be part of that 144,000? Is that all that's going to be saved? But when you begin to look down in the Word of God and you look at chapter 7, now verse 9, it says, and then he saw a number that no man could number. Oh, I can make that. A number that no man could number. I can be in that number. How about you? A number that no man can number. After this, he says, I beheld in law a great multitude which no man could number of all nations and kindreds and tongues and people who stood before the throne and before the Lamb, clothed with white robes and palms in their hands. A number that no one could number. That means that number is huge if you can't number it. But Jesus Christ is coming, loved ones. He's coming. And he's coming a lot sooner than many of us believe. I believe when I look at the events that are taking place today in this world, even our last election of the president, all the things that are taking place in the world is telling me this, Jesus is coming soon. Not because of our president, I'm not saying that. I'm saying the events that are taking place in the world all around our president. The things that are taking place in the world that he's going to have to deal with. And there's no real answer to any of them. And he's going to find that out. Because you see, God is in control. Not he. None of us are in control. God is in control. The time is coming. The time is coming when we will have to leave and move out of the cities if we're still here. Why? Because persecution will have to start taking place. She talks about that. And the only thing we can do is to live outside the cities and go in during the day to give Bible studies and to let people know, but then leave and come back out. She talks about that. And as I begin to look at this, she says that God's children will be put into jail. Prisons. But in the midst of all that will take place, the terror, the wicked, they hear the voices of the saints. Why? Because they hear a voice stating when Jesus is coming. The voice gives the hour. The saints rejoice. And then you hear something else. An earthquake takes place like no other earthquake has ever taken place. And when that earthquake takes place, the children of God walk out of the prisons that they are in, and they leave those prisons, and they look up, and they see their Lord coming. Coming. Can you imagine what it's going to be like? Jesus is coming. He's coming. The graves of the righteous open up and the saints come forth from their graves. Spirit of prophecy says that there'll be three resurrections. There'll be a resurrection of those who were at the cross when Jesus died, and they'll be brought forth so that they can see him come. There'll be a second resurrection of all those who died in the three angels' message. That's from 1844 on. They'll be caught up. And then the last will be all those saints who have died will also then be brought up in that third resurrection. Three resurrections. Two of them I don't mind being in. I don't want to be in the one that was around the cross. And I don't have to worry about that because I wasn't there. But can you imagine what the priests of the temple and Sadducees and Pharisees are going to feel when they look up and see that is Jesus, isn't it? He is coming. Loved ones, they come forth from their graves. They come forth and they're caught up in the cloud. The wheels now are beginning to move. All the saints now are on the heavenly chariot. And the wheels are saying, holy, holy, holy. That's what they're saying. The angels are saying, holy, holy, holy. Lord God Almighty. And all we can say is, thank you, Jesus. We are moving toward home at last. It will take us 7 days to get there. Why 7 days? I don't know. I just have a feeling that the one reason why it may take 7 days is because there are going to be a lot of Catholics and Pentecostals and Seventh-day Adventists and a lot of people who had a relationship with Jesus Christ, because you see, what saved us is not being a Seventh-day Adventist. What saves us is our relationship with Jesus Christ and obeying that which we know God wants us to obey. We're Seventh-day Adventists because we have a message that God has given us, a full truth. And that full truth is that we are Seventh-day Adventists. But there are going to be a lot of Catholics, there are going to be a lot of Methodists, there are going to be a lot of individuals who have had a relationship with Jesus Christ through the dark ages, and they will be saved. Can you imagine what it's going to be like? So I think that maybe when we start talking about those days going back to heaven, we're going to spend one day before we get to heaven on the Sabbath, so that we'll all be Seventh-day Adventists. When we get to heaven, one of those days will be spent, right? One of those days will be spent on the Sabbath before we get to heaven. And she goes on to say, that's where we will kind of catch up with our grandchildren on the way. You know, I can imagine that there'll be individuals, friends that we haven't seen in ages that have died. We'll be talking with them. And grandparents will see grandchildren they've never seen before. Oh, it's going to be a day, a wonderful day. See your brother, your sister that maybe have passed away. Families coming together during those 7 days. Spending that Sabbath together before we get to heaven. But then when we get to heaven, we're not going to walk into heaven right away. For there'll be a huge square. And in the middle of that square will be Jesus Christ outside the gates of the city. And when Adam starts walking toward Jesus, and they finally meet together for the first time in glory, that's going to be something. They say, Spirit of Prophecy says that Adam is just a little shorter than Jesus. And we're feeling that Jesus is somewhere between 15 to 16 feet tall. He will bow down before his maker. And he'll say, heaven is cheap enough. Loved ones, I want to be there. How about you? Jesus will give each one of us harps. Place on our head the crowns. You know, I wondered, loved ones, how long that's going to take. You're talking about millions of people being saved, and he's going to do this with each one? That's what she says. I'm not going to worry about that. That's not my problem. My problem is making sure I'm there. Amen? Because it's going to be something. When Jesus has finished giving us our harps and our crowns, then we'll begin to play our harps without a harp lesson. Isn't that amazing? Never played a harp before, but we'll play them that day. And we shall rejoice next week. Will be the second part of this sermon, which deals with what takes place when we get to heaven. What takes place when we get to heaven? What will heaven actually be like? And what will we do in heaven? And what will we see in heaven? We're going to be talking about heaven and what God has for us in heaven on next week. I hope and pray that God will bless that we will be here together next week.
Our closing song is number 341 in your hymnals, if you want to use your hymnals. And it's To God Be the Glory. Can I get you all to stand? The glory, great things he hath done. So loved he the world that he gave us his Son, who yielded his life and allurement for sin, and opened the life gate that all may go in. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Oh, perfect redemption, the purchase of blood, to every believer, the promise of God. The vilest offender who truly believes that moment from Jesus a pardon receives. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done. Great things he hath taught us, great things he hath done, and great our rejoicing through Jesus the Son. But purer and higher and greater will be one wonder our transport when Jesus we see. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord. Let the earth hear his voice. Praise the Lord, Praise the Lord, let the people rejoice. Oh, come to the Father through Jesus the Son, and give him the glory, great things he hath done.
Oh, praise the Lord, praise the Lord, for his coming is soon. And we are looking forward to the time when he shall break through the clouds of glory and we shall be taken back home with him. Oh Lord, bless us as we leave this place. And may we keep in our minds that Jesus Christ is waiting for us. And when he returns, he will take us back. In the name of Jesus, amen.